Good morning, everybody, and welcome to another Academic Hour brought to you by the GMOA Academic Subcommittee. So, today we have Dr. Indika Dilanarol, consultant emergency physician from the National Hospital of Sri Lanka, talking to us. To give a brief introduction about Dr. Dilanarol, he's a graduate from the University of Colombo, and he got his postgraduate education from the PGIM and also was the batch top in the very first MD Part 1 Emergency Medicine examination. He also obtained MD in Emergency Medicine in 2016 and was awarded the very first ACEM PGIM Gold Medal for Best Performance. Not only in Sri Lanka, he has also obtained training and qualifications in Australia and also is a member, has obtained the member of the Royal College of Emergency Medicine qualification. So he's also the first consultant to be board certified in emergency medicine in Sri Lanka. And he also has multiple publications. Under his name, he's the co-editor in Basic Course for Emergency Care Manual, Ministry of Health, Advanced Life Care Manual, Sri Lanka College of Emergency Physicians, member of the Editorial Committee for Professional Clinical Practice Guidelines on the COVID-19 Suspected and Confirmed Patient, Ministry of Health. He's also the past president of the Sri Lanka College of Emergency Physicians and secretary to the Board of Study in Emergency Medicine, council member of the Sri Lanka Medical Council, internationally accredited trainer in hospital preparedness for emergency, Asian Disaster Preparedness Center. And last but not the least, we are so proud that he is current president of the GMOA Branch Union, National Hospital of Sri Lanka. So over to you, Dr. Indika Dilanarol, to take us through the presentation, Doctor, I am dizzy, what not to miss.
Thank you, Rajiv, for that very, very kind introduction. Thank you, the GMOA, the GMO Academic Subcommittee, for initiating and continuing a very arduous task of getting everyone together in Sri Lanka and having a CEPD program, which is long overdue and which is happening in lots of parts of the country. So I had no hesitation in participating in this program. So when I was asked to choose a topic, I thought of, I'm an emergency physician, so everyone would have expected me to talk something in related to emergency. But I thought that I would take a very common complaint which does not look like an emergency but try to cover so many areas within the given 1 hour and how to dissect this problem of dizziness. At the end of this 1 hour, I hope that you would realize, even though this complaint looks very trivial, but there are things that might be missed, and if we miss, the patient is in trouble, and that patient one fine day might be you also. So that is the prelude. So if you go to the first slide, dizziness. Nothing dramatic about the complaint. It's a very poorly defined symptom. World over, any language, this is the case. People straight away come with dizzy. They all might complain giddy, faintish, vertigo, unsteady, I cannot walk. All these words comes under this one umbrella term called dizziness. If you go to any foreign country, it's a very difficult case to dissect, and as a result, some of the practitioners are in the courts also. So if you take about the etiology, I have only included four here. So majority of the patients who are presented with dizziness, they would have some kind of a vertigo. let's talk about this in the next one hour. And mind you, about 15% of them will have a pure psychiatric disorder. And about 25%, right, will have so many other causes. Presyncope, dystrophy, medicine, alcohol, you name, anything can be included here. So in Sri Lanka and in worldwide, when a patient comes with dizziness, if we don't know what we are dealing with, our general tendency is to start some types of an antivertigo medicine like a beta histidine and review. So there is a possibility 50% of the time, actually about 40% of the time you are right. 60% of the time you just need to pass the ball. That's where the problem lies. So let's see how to solve this problem. The issue here is, as I said, because there are so many causes for the dizziness, if you go wrong path, you made a wrong diagnosis. As a result, you might miss a very important diagnosis. An example is a patient comes with a syncope, a presyncope, which is called as faintishness in our colloquial terms. And if we diagnose this as vertigo, which is about 40 to 50% of the case, we might miss a very important life-threatening arrhythmia in this patient. It brings a very near past, we had a patient in the NHSLE 2U. The patient was treated in an hospital also as for Mallory-Weiss syndrome, hematemesis. So patient had multiple episodes of vomiting and mild dizziness. This was a young lady in her 40s, and she has been treated. She came to the hospital, treated with general anti-emetic medicine. Because she was a profuse vomiting, patient had a Mallory-Weiss like bleeding. So he has been given pantoprazole. And after 1 or 2 days, patient was discharged with the same medicine with the plan for outpatient endoscopy. There's nothing wrong what it was done. But she came after 2 days and she had a posterior circulation stroke which was missed. And she presented to the hospital within 1 hour of her initial complaint. So we missed an opportunity to thrombolyze this patient. I don't know whether we could have really done, because that needs a separate set of assessment. We missed that opportunity. As a result, this patient will be a permanently ataxic for the rest of the life. So that's how this disease can be. The simple word dizziness, there are lots of things that need to be think of. So I can give countless number of examples, but I don't think that is the place and the time for at the moment. So how are we going to this problem? Right, let's go through this journey in next 45 minutes, and I'm pretty sure if we keep it very simple that you will get an idea of how to do this, because emergency medicine is all about keeping things simple. Right, my topic which I am proposing is approach to a patient with dizziness. Worldwide, all dizzy patients can be categorized into 4 different subtypes. First one with dizzy patient with vertigo. Second one is dizzy patient with presyncope. Third one is a category called disequilibrium. Fourth one is, when we don't know, we say it's non-specific dizziness. So it's very simple, isn't it? So we have 4 different subtypes: vertigo, presyncope, disequilibrium, and non-specific dizziness. Right? So if we can put your dizzy patient into one of these categories, I think you have correctly dissect the problem of dizziness. That's what we are going to talk about. So about these subcategories of dizziness, vertigo. It's been medically defined as perception of movement where no movement exists. Movement ekak nathi thana movement ekak thiyena wage peena. The common thing is you get a spinning sensation. So that's one. The generally the important system here is CNS. The second condition is called presyncope. Kalante wage. Kalante kiyanne syncope. Kalante wage. You just feel bit of a lightheadedness and you are about to faint. The important system here is cardiovascular. The third subcategory of dizziness is called a disequilibrium. It generally happens when you walk. Right? Feeling of imbalance or unsteadiness or sensation of floating while walking. So generally people come with some sort of a gait abnormality. The problem must lie in either cerebellum, spinal cord or peripheral nerves. Then this category called non-specific dizziness. Leda again mono ehuwat leda kiyanne. You can't really pinpoint what it is. So we keep it as non-specific where any abnormality, a metabolic, endocrine, even psychiatric. I told you patients with initially in the slide, 15% patients who come with dizziness, vertigo, they have a pure psychiatric disorder. So in your private practice, you might get it. A patient comes with recurrent episodes of dizziness. And you might have missed a patient with a generalized anxiety disorder. Right? So these are the problems that we are going to encounter. So four categories. The problem is, it's easy to say. Then me karakena manusya agim prashnahane kamaruini. Right? So generally, kunwarpaya khaganat na samanjaya. That's how you get a vertigo pinta. So how to differentiate between categories? Then if you know the category, if you know the vertigo, you start treatment. Keep it very simple. So the most important thing is the history. This is a case series where they have identified 87% of the time, that is nearly 90% of the time, to differentiate between categories, to say it's vertigo, only the history is enough. Then we'll ask, I'm dizzy, kalante wage kila kiyai. They might say they're lightheaded, but you need to dig to find out what he's really talking about, whether it is vertigo. So about 74%, that is 3/4 of the time, history will only tell you this is presyncope or kalante or faintishness. And then for the psychiatric disorders about 55% and disequilibrium about 33%. So now, so far we have said dizziness is a difficult challenge to doctors. So there are four subcategories. To differentiate between four subcategories, the history is the most important thing. Either Sinhala, Tamil or English, whichever the native language, just ask the patient what exactly you feel. Don't let them tell, I am kalanti. Just ask what exactly. That will help you to identify what the problem is. And when it comes to the examination, that only will confirm it, what your initial suspicion is. So generally the important the examination systems are CNS, CVS, the positional changing of the symptoms, orthostatic blood pressure and pulse changes, and you observe the gait and the detection of nystagmus. So patient comes, if you In the emergency department, we do what is called a specific case specific examination. So in general medicine or any other thing, we do an entire patient examination. So in instead of general practice, or at the forefront, OPD, you will only have sometimes time to do a specific examination. So these are the specific thing that you need to consider and put your emphasis on. Right. Okay. Again, going back. Categories in dizziness. Now we know there are four categories. We know history and examination are the two most important thing out of what the history is the most important thing. Right. Now what to do? When a patient comes with dizziness. Let me propose a way to dissect this problem now. Say for example, Mr. Nimal comes here with a complaint of dizziness, right? Supposing he has any life-threatening problems, that is stable enough. I think what you first should do is to identify whether this patient is having vertigo or presyncope. Because that will help you about 60-70% of time to arrive at a diagnosis. So think of whether this patient has got vertigo or syncope. Rather than he letting you talk, now you direct him. Right? So vertigo or presyncope. To that, you need history and examination. Right? There's no other way. If you think this is vertigo, the generally most of the time you are right, about 50% of the time. What they generally describe in English is an illusion of movement. Either you move or your surrounding moves. If you go to a bit of physiology, the body position is a combination of three senses. One is the visual, one is the auditory, the semicircular canal system, the third one is a joint position. So vertigo is generally an abnormality in the head position, which needs to have one or two of these systems to go wrong. Right? So generally they are ill looking because the vertigo patient will be vomiting. These are clues that you might tell when the patient is not very clear about what it is. Yeah, this is vertigo. That's for the first thing to put into vertigo or presyncope. So generally they are ill looking, they are start vomiting. Right? They might, even though they does not come up with the words, they might show, right, my head is spinning, if you look at the patient. So that's where the vertigo is. The second one is faintishness, syncope, a very risky diagnosis. The common, I told you, the important thing is the cardiovascular system. So they might have cardiac precise well, like AS, MI. They come with dizziness, very likely they are having a syncope. And they might complain of chest pain, before that palpitation. The syncope happens, a transient loss of blood supply to the brain. As a result, they might be very pale during the episode. Then, and they have to recover at the time of come to the hospital. So they are not ill looking as a disease, as a vertigo patient. So these are subtle changes that might tell you this is a vertigo, this is syncope. So once you've done, let's think about vertigo. Now your patient is 40-year Mr. Nimal, and you have decided after deliberations, this is a patient with vertigo and what to do in the correct way. So causes of vertigo is multimodal. They are generally divided mainly into two. One is peripheral. So peripheral means from the semicircular canal in the inner ear and your cranial nerve 8, the vestibular cord. You know, anything in that line is called as peripheral, right? Which is generally benign. Then the worst part is central, sinister. Central means it involves the central nervous system. So from the nerve onwards, centrally, it will be pain. how to differentiate between two. This is the when you know the patient is having vertigo now, after going through the history, your next step is to find out whether the cause of vertigo, whether it is peripheral versus central. Right? So how not to miss a central cause? This particular patient who got vertigo should never has any CNS clinical feature. Should never has any CNS clinical feature. If you differentiate between two, the peripheral vertigo, they are generally very dramatic. These are the historical features. Whereas central vertigo, they are karakino, vamaniano, ekapata, una acute episode, generally with vertigo, that points towards a peripheral vertigo. Whereas central, it's not that dramatic. If you go to the causative factors, the peripheral vertigo can have ear symptoms, tinnitus, hearing loss. So generally they are absent in central vertigo. The important feature. The central vertigo will have central clinical features which are related to the central nervous system. That is because the cranial nerve 8, if you go to the anatomy of that, has so many other connections in the brainstem. Right, few examples are, they can have it diplopia. So if a patient comes with vertigo diplopia, that is central. Right, the cranial nerve that can be involved, these are academic interest, 3rd, 4th and 6th. They can have with dysarthria. We know 7th and 8th cranial nerve travel together. So they can have dysarthria. They can have dysphagia. 9th and 10th cranial nerves can be involved. Right? They can have any of the cerebellar signs. So these four Ds, dysphagia, dysarthria, diplopia, dysmetria, don't forget. Right? They can have any sort of sensory loss. Or motor weakness, if the motor tracts are involved. Just let them walk. Now, one might argue, karakenika kohomada aviddawanne kiyala. But in peripheral vertigo, you still can walk confidently, even though you feel dizzy. But in central vertigo, you literally cannot walk. Your walk is very unsteady. So that's the important definition. I don't want to go into this testing, but this is a test which the general practitioners world over does. A test called HINT test, which will help you to differentiate between central and peripheral. You only need to look for three things: head impulse, nystagmus, and something called test of skew. In the YouTube, there are enough videos, right? But this has a very high sensitivity and specificity in difference between central and peripheral vertigo. Right. Now what we have done up to now, patient come with dizziness. And we know there are four subcategories. Vertigo, presyncope, disequilibrium, non-specific. So what I am proposing here is keep it simple. First thing is identify whether this patient has vertigo or presyncope. To that, we have discussed how the history helps, how the examination helps. So once you have put this patient to this category called vertigo, the important thing is you should not miss a central cause of vertigo. So because there are two causes. The central cause can be a stroke, can be a tumor, multiple sclerosis, so many other central causes. Right? So that's the next one. So to differentiate between central and peripheral, there are some historical things. What we said was, in the history, the patient will be very ill looking. They can have, because peripheral vertigo, they have profuse vomiting, acute onset. They can have oral symptoms, tinnitus, because the involvement in the inner ear. Central vertigo, it's not that dramatic. It's generally, it can be a slow onset of symptoms, but they have central clinical features, diplopia, dysphagia, dysmetria, dystonia, because of the cranial nerves connection in the brainstem. And check the gait. So once you have done that, and then we discuss a test called HINT test, H-I-N-T, head impulse, nystagmus and test of skew. It's a very simple test done all over by the first care providers, which will help you to differentiate between central versus peripheral. Now you know your patient is having central. What to do? You have to find something in the central nervous system. So the imaging, CT, MRI, and need admission. No doubt, 100% patient cannot go home. If there's nothing central, consider this as peripheral vertigo. One caveat is old age. Tendency, we all are coming to that age. Sri Lanka has the second fastest aging population in entire Asia. Be mindful in diagnosing peripheral vertigo. Lots of countries, in an emergency department, if a patient above 50-60 years coming with vertigo, they would generally direct to patient to an MRI, generally. Right? Not to miss any central course, or a CT at least. But that they are practiced, so we can argue whether we can do that or not, that's a different story. So I don't know whether you all can, this is just a summarize of what we have done. So we know if the patient is having true vertigo, right? So once we do that, then the next step, whether to find out the central nervous system or not. If you think it's central nervous system, you are in the pathway where you need imaging. If it is not, you consider it as peripheral vertigo. And there are only 3 or 4 important causes. There are so many, please don't fight with me. But in your practice, most of the patients that you come with peripheral vertigo, they will fall into these 4 clinical conditions, either vestibular neuritis. Okay, these are these 4 conditions. One is called as benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. අපි මම දැකලා තියෙන්නේ ගොඩක් වෙලාවට we would put this patient into BPPV. That's the mistake that we do. Right? The clue here is it has to be paroxysmal. And it has to be positional. And it has to be with the sudden head movements. Then only that you can consider it as BPPV. And there's a maneuver called Dick's Halspike. These are not any high-fi maneuvers. These are being done by even the general practitioners in foreign countries. If we are considering ourselves to upgrade our level, everybody needs to do this. Then there are no exclusive people who can do this. Right? Dick's Halspike maneuver. And the treatment is antivertigo medicine. And there's a maneuver called Eplis. Kemak tino Eplis kila karan. E kemak alham samalata meka hariyan. The second condition is a common thing called vestibular neuritis and acute labyrinthitis. Those are 2 hand in hand. The vestibular neuritis, the vestibular nerve inflammation, generally both conditions are associated with either upper respiratory infection or otitis media. The difference between 2 is in the vestibular neuritis, it's only hearing loss because the labyrinthitis means there's a bony labyrinth within that internal auditory meatus, structures are lined, so that bony labyrinth get inflamed. As a result, the vestibular cochlea, both parts of the nerve get inflamed. So you get, apart from hearing loss, you get the vertigo and as well as tinnitus. And we all know about the manias. I don't want to go into that detail, right? Generally above 50 years, coming with vertigo, all 3 components, hearing loss and tinnitus. And the other thing that looks bit dreaded is an acoustic neuroma, a schwannoma of the vestibular nerve. So if you leave that part at least, acoustic neuroma, 1, 2, 3, 4, BPP, vestibular neuritis, acute labyrinthitis, and Meniere's syndrome. So your peripheral vertigos, majority will fall into these categories. Majority. Right? So now we know patient is vertigo, we know it's not central. Central, very easy, admit, investigate. Peripheral, we know how to detect. History and DICS and the hint testing. And once we know it's peripheral, majority of patients will fall into these categories. I can't be touching all the peripheral causes, but these are the majority. BPP, vestibular, acute abdominal death, many a syndrome. And these are the treatment modalities that can be given. And you can see all patients will benefited with anti-vertigo medicine. Right? Vestibular neuritis and acute labyrinthitis, there's a place for steroid. Controversial, but there's a place for steroids. And if they both have got an upper respiratory infection, treat accordingly. Meniere's is a different entity. Right? So, a majority of the time, you might need the help of an ENT specialty. So, I think this is a gold mine for the private practice, isn't it? Like lots of people would come with this problem. I'm sorry, the word gold mine is not very ethical to use, but I please delete that from the Hansard, but that's how it is. So, about anti-vertigo medicine. We all think it's a beta histidine is the anti-vertigo medicine, isn't it? But the people who invented beta histidine doesn't think so. So these are the anti-vertigo medicines. As you can see, even the benzodiazepines can be used. So your good old diazepam can be used if the patient is having vertigo. These antiemetics. Metoclopramide, ondansetron, procoperazine, promethazine. I'm not going to use the trade names here. So these are the anti-vertigo medicine. Beta histidine technically is for the chronic use only. You cannot use the patient for the acute vertigo. So use any of these categories in combination or in isolation as anti-vertigo medicine. Okay, now this patient, we know DC patient, vertigo, how to dissect the patient with vertigo. The second condition that we said is a condition called a presyncope. So this DC patient can be having a presyncope also. So what is this presyncope? There are two conditions. One is called as syncope and other one is as presyncope. So technically a syncope, kalanthe kiyana eka, Sinhalen, I'm sorry, I don't know what the Tamil word for that, kalanthe kiyana eka. There should be two prerequisites. One is there should be a brief loss of consciousness and loss of postural tone. So those are the two prerequisites, and they should recover without any medical intervention. The udaharanayak widiyata hypoglycemia. The chances of them recovering without a medical intervention is low, isn't it? So the hypoglycemia cannot be a cause of a syncope. Api ehema hitanawanna puluwan kiyala. So syncope means a brief loss of consciousness plus postural tone, and they should recover without medical intervention. We'll dissect the syncope part in the next few slides, but that is called presyncope. But then DC kiyana ekkena ge sihi nathi villak naha ne, there's no loss of consciousness. Kalanthe wage. So that condition is called as presyncope, which you only lose the postural tone. But there's no loss of consciousness. That's the one for the presyncope. So which one is worse? Syncope, the presyncope. The common wisdom, if you say the 50% of the time, you would put the syncope. The both you should treat at an equal respect. Both are of similar intensity. Right? So, ehinda, if a patient comes with dizziness, kalante wage kiyala kiwoth eka ganang nogen innepa. Right, then kohomada meka ganan ganna. So, if you go to the causative origins, syncope walata, there are only three causes. One is called as neurogenic. You get an autonomic activation, you got a vasodilatation, you collapse. Eka is a protective mechanism. You get sudden vasodilatation because the cerebral blood supply goes down. As a result, you fall, the blood passively passes to the brain. You recover. අපිට තරහ ගියම කලන් තියෙන්නේ. So that's called vasovagal situation, even carotid sinusitis. That. So that's one cause of syncope. The second cause is called as orthostatic hypotension. Primary and secondary, where you get autonomic failures. වෙන්න පුළුවන්නේ. And then නැකිට ගමන් කලන්ත ගතියක් ඇවිල්ලා ඇඳට ආයෙ බුදිය ගන්න අපි. So that's the second category. So these are the causes of syncope and presyncope. The third category is the most important category. A syncope can be due to a heart problem. Syncope can be due to heart problem. This is the category we should not be missing. So your dizzy patient might have a very sinister cardiac ailment unless you actively look for that. Right. Kalantayak ahama, in your mind think about it, what would you request? What is the, what are the most important investigations? Think about it. The two most important investigations are ECG and echo. Because when it comes to the heart, can be it either can be to a structural problem, which an echo will be helpful. It can be an electrical rhythm problem, with an ECG is helpful. So any kalante manusyayekuta at least take an ECG with the rhythm strip. Most of the time we do a CT. I don't know, most of the time I know, I have seen people doing it. Even I myself have done that. So that's the wrong way of looking at this problem. ECG and echo. Right. I thought to make this bit interesting. So I said, in a patient with dizziness who comes with syncope or presyncope, ECG is the most important thing. But then you should know what to look for the ECG, the disease specific ECG interpretation. So ECG that comes, there can be so many abnormalities. What if you all know? These are the things that we should essentially look for pertaining to this presenting complaint. That's what I am going to tell you now. First thing is ischemia. So your ST elevations, LBB, STEMI equivalence, Aslanga patterns, AVR reanimation, T inversion, everything comes under this thing. So if a patient comes with a dizziness, you think there's an ischemic ECG change. It's there. A cardiologist to sort it out. Refer to cardiologist. Or refer to hospital, to the ED. So they will do the necessary testing and say, oh, look here, these are sinister or not. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that you should not miss this, any arrhythmia. Starting from sinus tachycardia, sinus bradycardia, first degree heart block, complete heart block, any electrical abnormality. So you should not miss that. You have it, you refer to the hospital, to the ED, or to the cardiologist, or to any specialty that you deem necessary. Otherwise, I will be in the wrong books if I name specialties here, right? So, that's the second thing. You should not be missing an arrhythmia. Third thing is the one that is the interesting thing. What else? So, there are three congenital diseases and two conduction defects that you should specifically look for. Right? Three congenital diseases, two conduction defects. Now, so far, I have spoken. Now it is time to you all to speak. Okay, what is this? This is an actual patient, a 44-year-old patient who came with syncope. And I said the most important instigation, who came with dizziness. And by history examination, now we have known this is not vertigo, that's the first thing. And now we think this is syncope. And I propose the most important investigation, bedside, is getting an ECG. Apart from his general examination and finding. And this is the ECG. What is there? There's an elite crowd in front of me, so I can ask them. Now go through the way that I said. Are there any signs of ischemia here? A. Do you think there's an arrhythmia? Looks like a very sinus, nice rhythm, isn't it? Right? Ischemia, you might say V2, T inversion, people might say different things, right? That's okay, right? The third thing, now why did I put this ECG? I want to emphasize on three congenital diseases and two conduction diseases. So, if you have a kanapot, make arrhythmia in not there, ischemia in not there, pain at here. So, either one of five of these conditions. So, don't tell this is ST elevation. What is this? Someone has said, Mr. Dr. Tilakaratna has said it's focal. Agree, disagree? Dr. Tilakaratna, you are right. I think he needs a round of applause for that. So this is a condition called hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Namadi guy, now what to look for in the ECG, in the hokum. Then may syncope patient, ECG dia balua. Ischemia ne, arrhythmia ne, and I am proposing that you should specifically look for hokum. For that, there are only 2 or 3 ECG changes that you need to look for. What are they? One is a giant QRS complexes. They make it a lookuata ne, it's like an LVH pattern. They make it thin on it. So if you go here, you have very deep S wave, and so it's very deep R wave. So, may V1 and V6, one AVA lesion, there will be like an LVH, very giant QRS complexes, because you get a septal hypertrophy in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, an asymmetrical septal hypertrophy. So, you get a giant QRS complexes, like an LVH. Now, that's one of the things. But the more important thing is this, which is called as a Dragger Q wave. Q waves, Q hama generally is pathological when the pulwang can be benign also. So benign Q waves, we generally say are ischemic wave. They are more than 1 millimeter, small square millimeter width, and the depth is more than 2 small squares. Dragger kiyanne mokadda singale? Kinissa. Kinissa kohomada? Kettui digai, narrow and deeper. So these are called Dragger Q waves. So you should not miss a Dragger Q wave. Commonly in one AVL V5, V6, but can be in inferior leads also. So this 44-year-old Mr. Nimal had vertigo, let's say Ajit. And you know by your history it's not vertigo. You think it's syncope. And you take an ECG. You look for the ischemic changes. There's nothing. You look for any arrhythmia. There's nothing. Then you directly say just cardiac syncope. It's not for us to say it's not. then he needs a further set of medication. But specifically, if you don't have any arrhythmia or ischemia, please look for Holcomb. The clue here is look for Dräger Q waves and very bizarre looking QRS complexes. So that's one condition. I said three congenital conditions. Okay, second one. This is easy. Anyone would tell that. A 30-year-old patient came with presyncope, colanthine, dizzy, giddy. Any answers from the audience? Multiple answers, that's Brugada. Everyone knows about this. It's a channelopathy, sodium channel problem. There are three patterns they talk about. The exam me kya hoot? Cold upward ST segments. Ima tamai kya sudda. In the like cold upward ST segment. Here, number one. Right? And there can be a saddleback like here. ST segments. Third pattern එක දෙකටම නැති එක. So we have to interpret this ECG in the context of patient presentation for 44-year-old patient who comes with a history of dizziness. You know it's not vertigo, you think it's presyncope, cardiac risk factor තියෙන මොන හරි එකක් කළ presyncope කියලා හිතුවොත් in the ECG you take no ischemia, arrhythmia, no Holcomb, Dräger Qs, bizarre Qs. The second one to look for is Brugada. Right, so look at these V1, V2, V3 ECG pattern. The thing is, the Brugada is not a permanent pattern sometimes. Right, it can come and go with the stress. When I was a trainee, I missed a Brugada patient, a patient who was transferred from presidential secretariat. At the corner, like Java thing, Gamayan or anything. And we thought it's Brugada, and actually, patient had a pneumonia. So we missed it. Right? So that's the case. So, patient come in, because these patterns comes and go. The Brugada, they could look for other causes also, like any stress in the body. They are generally misdiagnosed as having right bundle branch blocks and also STEMI and V1, V2, V3, ST up. So you can have. Right, so this is the second congenital thing that you should not be missing. Right? Third one. Very underdiagnosed condition even in Sri Lanka, but people have died because of them. I've seen Lakmal has given an answer. Anyone, any other suggestions? Yes, well done, Dr. Lakmal. It's a condition called arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. Make a Lankawi Tieno. Especially people who do school medical wary of this condition. Right ventricle, there's a fibrotic patch, and as a result, they get VTVF, especially when you exert yourself. By marriage, lama inge hime tibila thiyena post mortem. So, what to look for? Any guesses? I mean, ECG ke man kiyanne look for these changes. The most important thing is something called epsilon wave. But only present in 30% of the time. So it's commonly seen in V1, V2, you get another positive deflection at the end of QR. Then V1 ke generally in ne you get a P wave and a negative QRS complex ekak ne tiyenne. Dominant R wave ekak enna ne generally if you see the V1. Generally enne ne. But this condition at the end of the QRS. Mark ekak ne. At the end of the QRS, there is another positive deflection. That is called epsilon wave. මම කියන්නේ මේ හැම එකකම ECG changes දෙකයි තුනයි මතක තියාගන්න. It's very easy. Right? So only two changes. Epsilon wave, but that's the problem here is only 30% of the time. 80% of the time, you get a T inversion in V1, V2, V3. Without RBB. Then RBB එකක් ගත්තොත් right bundle branch block එකක් ගත්තොත් you get an RSR pattern followed by a ST depression no T inversion. That's the normal thing. Then මේ RBB එකක් තියෙනකොට it's difficult to diagnose මේ conditions. Very upset නේ වැඩි. But then we have to be extra careful. But for the people with arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy නැත්නම් arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia, they might have T inversions with a broad QRX 85% of the time, V1, V2, V3, T inversion. Then kaata hari denna pulang eka normal nan pulang kiyala. Yes, normal, but in the context of the patient. Da api nikan inne manusyekota medical ekak kala wage ekeni men DC manusyek karanawa kiyala kiyanne. But a young patient coming with a similar symptom, why not refer rather than he end up being having a death? The primary care and the OPD and the ED is all about detecting patients with problems. So we should be all good escalators. Right. Now, this 40-year-old Mr. Ajit, who came with dizziness, we took the history, we knew it's not vertigo. We think it's presyncope and we think the most important thing is to get an ECG. And we do what is called a disease-specific ECG interpretation, which we said we will look for any arrhythmia, any ischemia, and three congenital diseases. Eket he hama congenital disease ekama ECG changes dekak vithara thamai thiyenne. So congenital diseases that we describe are OCM, LVH pattern wage giant QRS complexes or the Drager QAs, and the Brugada code up with ST elevations. And the last one is arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia, which has epsilon wave or V1 to V3 T inversion. Right, so these are the ECG changes we think. Okay, right, what else? Then I said two conduction defects. This ECG. Thirty-two-year-old came with dizziness. මේ ළඟදී ගෑනු ළමයෙක් ආව who has been treated for fit because this was missed for 2 years. I'm not a big boss to like criticize others, but these are things. I also might be missing lots of things, but I'm saying these are things that can happen unless we are alert to these facts. This is a patient with a long QT, QT interval. If the QT is prolonged, that means start of the QRS complex to the end of the T wave, they can be predisposed to VT and VF. So when you get a VT, you might get a syncope. At the end of the syncope, you might get a fit. And somehow we'll have to pay in the fit killer treatment, unless we get a proper history. That's what that happened to that girl. A few words about QT, how to calculate. QT is a rate dependent. So there people use a formula called Bassett. There are so many formulas, but the common one is the Bassett formula. Where you divide QT of the square root of the RR interval. Right? I'm not going to do any calculations here, but this is how you do it. And if generally, 450 value, but it's male female වෙනසක් තියෙනවා but 450 වෙන above නම් prolong කියලා කියන්න 500 milliliter per second above නම් is definitely worrying. But for us, I think if it's above a patient come with dizziness, the QT, corrected QT is above 450, even 55, I think we should refer. We should refer them. even your general practice, OPD, ETU, PCU, any level, emergency department level, ANE levels, please refer. So that is one way of calculating. The second one is the easy way, eyeball method of calculating QT. Make a hurry, but I often also does that in a hurry. So when you take the QT interval, I told you, it's from start of Q to end of T. Right? So if you take two QRS complexes, adjacent QRS complexes, if you take this from the start of the Q wave in the first ECG, at the end of T wave, minne me length ekak gattot, right? Me length ekak gattot, the first ECG ek first T wave ek should end, if you divide this into half, the T wave should end in the first half. Ek anip patra gattot, if you take an RR interval from R to R, if you divide into 2 RR interval, this T should end in the first half. And if it goes beyond first half, that's an indication that there's a QT prolongation. Make an eyeball, this is not the 100% correct way. Right? Ar porawa ge kiyan ekak tamai meka, which I have at the luxury of sometimes. Eka hema eken, but it's wrong. You need to do the balance. So you need to check for the QT interval. Okay, so I said three congenital, two conduction. First conduction is QT. What is this? Another easy one. 10 minutes, you know? A 24-year-old patient coming with Lakmal type A kilam, I don't know. Okay. I think Lakmal is right. It's a condition called WPW, a Wolf Parkinson White syndrome. A kid, dekai matagati agante. The fashionable thing is the delta wave, which I don't want to describe, but the one that we forget is short PR interval. PR interval is 0.12 to 0.2. So it is 10.12. So if your patient has, 24-year-old patient has even a single short PR interval who comes with dizziness, we are not the goat to say this is not the WPW. There are trained people for that. So please refer rather than disregarding them. So that's the second thing. So this Mr. Nimal, 43-year-old patient who came with dizziness, we know it's not, I said, first thing is vertigo, the syncope. So from the history examination, we know it's not vertigo. Then we think of it's syncope. Most important investigation is ECG. ECG came on QA. Few things. Look for any ischemic changes, because out of the syncope, pre-syncope, most important etiology is not to miss is cardiac syncope. Ehinda ECG is important kila kiwe. So what you should do is to take an ECG, do what is called a disease specific ECG interpretation rather than looking at ECG as a whole. So you look actively for any ischemic changes, say then it's cardiac. You look actively for any arrhythmia, then it's cardiac. Then there are five things that you should not miss. Three congenital diseases, Holcomb, Brugada, arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, and two conduction defects, long QT and W. It's very simple. You miss it, somebody might pay with his life, his whole life. These things are happening. Right. So the approach, Mr. Nimal, and now we'll say Mr. Kamal. 44-year-old patient, now Ajit to Nimal to Kamal, came with dizziness. Ajit had vertigo. I said the first thing is, think whether it is vertigo or syncope. For there are four causes. Vertigo, syncope, disequilibrium, non-syncope. Then make a kadaganda pekum, because there are 150 causes. So first thing is vertigo and syncope. So the Ajit had vertigo. So we discuss how to dissect vertigo, central versus peripheral, here. Then Nimal had syncope, right? So we think it's cardiac syncope exclude current only here. So we think echo and ECG, we discuss about ECG. Now come normal. Syncope ne, vertigo ne. What I am proposing is then think of disequilibrium and non-specific syncope. I mean, ulu mukha kari krame ekata hada ganna. Ethoda ulu awul wenna ne. This is what I propose and this is how it has worked for me. So you develop whatever your method that suits for you. But I think I have found that this is very easy. Okay, few words about disequilibrium. And make a disequilibrium can equilibrium make an equine. So it comes with, I told you, mainly a complaint that will be associated with walking. Balance එකක් නැහැ. දැන් මේ DC campaign එක මම කියන්නේ it's a very complicated thing that how they come out with this කියලා. Now the starting is it is more related the positional ආවනේ vertigo එකේ BPP වගේ change of position කියලා. මේ disequilibrium කියන category එකේ they generally describe things with walking. ඇවිදිනකොට තමයි මේ ප්‍රශ්නේ තියෙන්නේ කියලා. So as a result generally they are chronic problems. කාලයක් තිස්සේ තියෙන Right, so in the emergency department, chances of us ETU level like that are but OPD in foreign EDs, where they see all category 3 posts, it's a very common complaint. Your general practice is, might be very common complaint. Your clinic practice, you might be very common complaint. So when you think of the course of the ataxia, the first year medical knowledge can be from the cerebellum where the coordination happens. It can be sensory, that means inputs happen, and it can be due to musculoskeletal problems with the gait. Right? So when you think about the cerebellar causes, you divide pathologically, pupular divide, the same thing. Now I said that most of the problems are chronic, but the one which are highlighted, like a stroke, ischemia, hemorrhage, they are the conditions that are generally acute. These are generally posterior cerebral circulation. They have hari monkey suckle changes. You can have posterior cerebral circulation TIA with a very suckle vertigo, very suckle dizziness, very suckle ataxia. So they come in generally acute. And all others, you can see the reasons. Multiple sclerosis, alcohol, medicines, vitamin E and generic, they are generally chronic problems. Then me, normal me posterior is the gun yan happy there. So, the second thing which I said was sensory. Right? Api commonly B12 den niti eka hari wage. Eka hari wage, right? Peripheral neuropathy. And people, you have the nerves, proprioception, and when it comes to the spinal cord, posterior column, the AVD may affect in the pulva. So any problem with the sensory can be peripheral, it can be spinal cord, and it can be cerebellum. Muscle. So any patient like Parkinson's who has got musculoskeletal dizziness, they might complain of dizziness like amaru yavidinne kiyala vertigo. So this Nimal comes with dizziness. So first thing to exclude this. Vertigo, they can think to exclude this syncope, then think of disequilibrium. A condition tunai, whether it's a cerebellar problem, it is a sensory problem, is it a motor problem. A few words about disequilibrium, it's acuity, I told you, acuity will help you determine the cause, stroke. Right? The important system that you should focus is a neurological system. Right? So these are the examination things that you need to look for. Gait, please look, it's there in everywhere in the books, right? But for the completeness sakes, I have included. Right. Then Nimalta, if it is disequilibrium, you think of these things, then you look for the cause with your examination and investigation and manage accordingly. Because the problem is more neurological, it is rational to think that they should get involved. Right? Okay. Now comes Kama. Right? A 44-year-old man. These are the last few slides. Right? 44-year-old man who comes with dizziness. So what to do? Think of vertigo. History examination. Eka neme. Then syncope, pre-syncope. Ekat neme. Then think of this equilibrium kira syndrome එකක්. ඒකේ more examination එක CNS. Either cerebellum, sensory or motor. Then treat accordingly. ඕකත් නෙමෙයි නම් අපි medicine වල දන්නේ නැත්තම් මොකද කරන්නේ? Non specific කියලා කියනවා. Iatrogenic කියලා. And එහෙම වචනයක් තියෙන dizziness එකක් තමයි දැන් තියෙන්නේ. Non specific dizziness. But the problem here is if you look for the causes of non specific dizziness, there's a big cohort called psychiatric causes. So in your practice, you might come a patient with a major depression, generalized anxiety, panic disorder, somatization, right? These are few of the things, alcohol dependence, personal disorders. You really can't find any cause, examination normal, examination normal. So about 15% of them, the entire cohort of dizziness, they will have one of these psychiatric problems. So even though it's non-specific, this is an important cause. Right, last slide. Time is right. So in summary, we discuss about disease. And we agreed upon that it's a very bizarre complaint. Can be very straightforward at times, but majority of the time, DC is being used for so many like a GMO. හොඳටත් නරකටත් දෙකටම අල්ල ගන්න ඕනේ. එහෙම එකට use කරන එකක් තමයි dizziness කියන්නේ. In the dizziness, there are hidden important life organ threatening conditions. So our exercise, we tried make allagan to get this dizziness. So we divide dizziness into four, not me, but people who invented the medicine, divide the dizziness into four major subtypes: vertigo, pre-syncope, disequilibrium, non-specific. Then I propose anyone coming with dizziness initially think whether the patient is having vertigo or pre-syncope. Ekata most important thing is history examination. Vena vidiyak atte mena ekata. Ahala ahala ahaganna one ekak. When you know vertigo, then we describe how to analyze vertigo. Important thing is central causes should not be missed. එහෙමනම් MRI, CT, imaging තමයි පැත්ත. Peripheral causes තමයි අපි generally දකින්නේ. In your private practice, in your OPD, in the emergency, in the PCU, wherever it is. අපි ඒක ගැන ටිකක් කතා කළා. ඒකට බේත් කරන හැටි ගැන ටිකක් කතා කළා. Then the second cause is called as syncope, pre-syncope. Important thing is cardiac and the most important thing is ECG. Then we discuss about what not to miss in a patient with pre-syncope in an ECG. Ischemia, arrhythmia, three congenital diseases, Holcomb, Brugada, right ventricular arrhythmogenic dysplasia, and two conduction defects, long QT and WPW. The second one is called as a disequilibrium. A complaint එක ලෙඩා කියන්නේ ඇවිදිනවත් එක්ක තමයි ගොඩක් complaints තියෙන්නේ. And think of disequilibrium. We said it's either musculoskeletal, sensory, spinal cord or cerebellum. ඉතින් ඒක investigate කරලා බලන්න. එහෙම හරියන්නේ නැත්නම්, ඒ තුනටම අයිති වෙන්නේ නැත්නම්, there's an entity called non-specific dizziness. AK, don't forget, 15% of time it can be a psychiatric disorder. That's it. I hope that I stick to the time.
Thank you very much, sir, for that in-depth explanation on the approach to a patient with dizziness. And thank you for making yourself available here in person to do the presentation. I think the crowd has got a lot of knowledge, and it was a complete lecture on the approach of to a patient with dizziness. So thank you everybody for coming online and taking part in the GMOA Academic Hour. Hope you were able to refresh your knowledge on the approach to a patient with dizziness. So let's meet again in a fortnight's time with another interesting CPD lecture. Till then, goodbye.